Spinal infections are a demanding diagnostic and treatment problem that often requires for its solution a multidisciplinary approach from spinal surgeons, either orthopedic or neurosurgeons, as well as radiologists for the diagnosis and laboratory physicians, as well as infectious diseases specialists. They are usually caused by bacterial macroorganisms that are most commonly pyogenic cocci and most commonly staphylococcus, less commonly by granulomatous microorganisms such as tuberculosis and brucellosis, and less commonly by fungi and exceptionally by parasites such as echinococcus. Any part of the spine can be affected, so there can be a spondylodiscitis, infection of the vertebral body and the vertebral disc, or discitis alone, that is infection only of the intervertebral disc. It can also spread through many spinal segments, especially in children, that can extend in many spinal levels, starting from the initial infection site. So depending on the site of the infection and its spread, spinal infections can be named as shown in the first column of this table. The overall incidence of spinal infection is approximately 2.2 cases every 100,000 spinal operations per year. And as we may see from these from the numbers in this table, the rate of spinal infections are pretty much higher compared to other primary orthopedic operations, except of course revision, total joint arthroplasties, and infected tumor prosthesis. Spinal infections are twice most common in more common in men compared to women, which is an unexplained observation, cannot be explained why. And they are most common in adults aged more than 50 years. This has to do with the immunosuppression and possible drug administration for this patient group, or any implants in intravascular devices that are more common in this age group compared to younger patients. In contrast, in younger patients, the more common spinal infections in patients with immunosuppression, or patients with intravenous drug abuse, prisoners, immigrants, etc. The spinal infection is more common in the lumbar spine, followed by the thoracic spine, and less common in the cervical spine. Many risk factors for a spinal infection, any disease or any drug or any previous entity or operation, spinal surgery or intravascular procedure or procedure with implants can be a potential risk factor for a spinal infection. Also, any condition that results in the circulation of microorganisms in the bloodstream, that is bacteremia or septicemia, Greek words, any condition of this can result in a spinal infection. And this can be either a surgical operation or ordinary daily activities such as toothbrushing and bleeding in the teeth, venous punctures. But most common reasons for a secondary spinal infection is infection in another system, and more commonly in the genitourinary tract. So the hematogenous spread of an infection to the spine is the most common etiopathogenesis for a spinal infection. Second is the continuous spread from an adjusted infection, a less common direct inoculation, as we may see in postoperative spinal infections or infections of the spine after local trauma. In most cases, the infection involves two adjacent vertebral bodies, and it starts from the vertebra, for the adjacent vertebral end plates. And this is because of the specific vascularization of the area, because we know that the same vascular pedicle bifurcates and supplies the adjacent vertebral end plates. Also, in this vascular system, the blood flow is slow, the vessels lack valves, and there is convolution of arteries and veins. So all these correlate to and lead to a spinal infection. In children, the infection can spread even more easily and more distally from the primary site because the blood vessels supply also the end plates as well as the intervertebral discs. The patients usually present with back or neck pain depending on the area of the infection. Occasionally, the pain is radiating if there is involvement of nerve roots of the upper or the lower extremity. Occasionally, the pain aggravates at night, as we see in tumors. Rarely the patient has fever. We see that in pyogenic infections, fever accounts for approximately 50% of the cases, which is a lot less in patients with fungal tuberculosis and brucellosis infection. A standard, a typical symptom is marked local tenderness of the spine, which accounts for around 75 to 95% of the cases, and neurological symptoms of presentation account only for approximately 30% of the cases. Many different variable diagnostic algorithms. All these algorithms begin from the patient itself and it starts from the clinical, from a medical history, clinical examination of the patient, and then we proceed with the laboratory examination, radiographs, imaging, and biopsy and cultures. So radiographs and MRI with contrast medium are the gold standard studies for the diagnosis of a spinal infection, and this should include the entire spine because, as we said before, the infection starts from a site of the spine, but it may extend to many adjacent vertebral areas. Regarding bone scintigraphy, can be used all the typical, the classic bone scans, such as with technetium or gallium, all level leukocytes. However, they have a low specificity and specificity, and for these cases, a negative exam is more diagnostic to rule out the infection. I mean, if the bone scan is negative, so the patient most likely does not have a spinal infection. Newer tracers are promising, such as indium labeled biotin and streptavidin, that bind with high affinity to specific sites with viable bacterial growth, as well as other radio-labeled antifungal tracers, and also PET-CT that is, however, recommended only in cases that MRI is not indicated for the patient for patient-specific reasons. At least two sets of blood cultures should be obtained, one for aerobic and second for anaerobic bacteria. And also, they should be obtained specific culture for in specific media for specific microorganisms such as tuberculosis and fungi. In approximately 60% of the cases, cultures will be positive and will return a specific bacteria isolate. If not, then CT-guided biopsy, needle aspiration biopsy, closed biopsy under CT guidance is recommended, except if the patient is in severe ill and has an indication for a surgical operation. So in this case, the surgeon should proceed directly with a surgical operation. The sensitivity of CT-guided percutaneous needle aspiration biopsy is around 50%, and as also again as we see as we do in tumor biopsies, the needle should be aimed at the soft tissue area of the lesion. In this case, for the infection, and in this case, the diagnostic accuracy is 2.28% higher compared to bone tissue biopsy. If the closed biopsy is not diagnostic, then the surgeon may proceed with an open biopsy that usually gets a diagnostic accuracy of 68 to 93%. You see a large range of diagnostic accuracy. However, if clinical symptoms and imaging are typical for spinal infection and blood cultures are positive for a common pathogen and most commonly for a staphylococcus, then a needle biopsy is not required. If these criteria are not met, then the patient should proceed with the biopsy or West Risk Alteration and Nobel Biopsy if indicated. Histology is very helpful. It may show leukocytes that indicate a bacterial infection, a pathogenic infection, or it may show granulomas that indicate Mycobacterium tuberculosis or Brucella, or it may show parasites, such as these scolicus, questodes, that are typical of Echinococcus granulosus. A differential diagnosis of spinal infections should mostly include spinal tumors, as in this case, which was a case of spinal tuberculosis. Also, rarely, exceptional cases may be misdiagnosed for a spinal stenosis with extensive, however, degenerative changes, or with herniated large nucleus pulposus, disc, and other rare entities, which can be differentiated from a spinal infection with MRI. Regarding its their microbiology, usually spinal infections are related to a single microorganism in most cases. In contrast, polymicrobial infections account for less than 10% of the cases. The source of the spinal infection is identified in approximately 50% of the cases, and most commonly this is located in the genital urinary tract, followed by the heart, skin soft tissue, GI, and respiratory system. Microbes are usually in these three categories: most commonly bacteria, pyogenic infection, and most commonly Staphylococcus aureus, less commonly fungi, parasites, and not very rare, but not very common also, more common in specific endemic areas, Mycobacteria, tuberculosis that account currently for approximately 20 to 25% of cases of spinal infections worldwide. This has its name is called also geographic microbiology, and other typical examples are brucellosis that are endemic in Mediterranean and Middle East countries. In these cases, the spine is involved in approximately 6 to 12% of the patients with brucellosis, or echinococcosis, as we see in the bottom photographs, that are more common in endemic areas with crow warm climate, such as Africa, South America, Central Asia, China, Australia, and other countries. The goals of the treatment are eradication of the spinal infection, as well as eradication of the patient's symptoms, that is pain relief, return of spinal stability, eradication if there were any neurological symptoms and dysfunction. All patients have the right for conservative treatment. So in these cases, this is the same, and hopefully conservative management is successful in more than 90% of the patients with a spinal infection. So most patients with spinal infection do not need a surgical operation. Conservative treatment requires appropriate antibiotics, as well as bed rest, analgesics, spinal brace immobilization, physical therapy, and rehabilitation. Antibiotics should be started ideally after there is a bacteria isolation, except if the patient is severe ill or it has an indication for a surgical operation, then the surgeon should proceed immediately to the operation and start empirical antibiotic therapy. There's another debate regarding the optimal duration of antibiotics. Most authors recommend a course of 4 to 6 weeks of antibiotics, starting with around 2 weeks of intravenous antibiotics. Others recommend up to 3 months for a typical pyogenic spinal infection. There is also a debate regarding the optimal duration of antibiotics for brucellosis and tuberculosis. For brucellosis, they recommend 3 to 6 months, for tuberculosis up to 1 year or even longer. The challenges has to do with undrained abscesses, either abscesses that cannot or were not drained. For the patient who have spinal instrumentations in place and these are infected, especially if there is a late postoperative infection, so these implants are most likely colonized by biofilm forming bacteria. And of course, in children, because we have no guidelines, and usually we use the guidelines that are correspond to adults. Indication for surgical treatment include these five indication. First, if there is failure of conservative treatment at 4 or most likely at 6 weeks, and the failure has to do with persistent fever, pain, persistent pain, and persistent high levels of SERPE. Second, if there's imaging evidence of progressive destruction of the spinal column, that is progressive bone loss, spinal instability, if there are progressive neurological deficits, spinal instability, and spinal canal abscesses and paravertebral abscess formation of more than 2.5 centimeters in maximum diameter. Also, a lot of algorithms related to surgical treatment. The primary criterion for this algorithm is the occurrence of spinal instability and neurological deficits. In any case, in surgical treatment, the patient has to undergo thorough and extensive debridement, decompression, and surgical lavage that usually ideally has to be performed from the anterior approach, because most likely, most commonly, the vertebral bodies and the end plates and the intervertebral disc are affected. So the anterior approach is a more direct approach. However, the posterior approaches are also useful because paravertebral abscesses and abscesses in the posterior spinal elements are better drained and washed from the posterior approach. There is another debate regarding the optimal surgical procedure after debridement. I mean, either implants can be left in place or not. And of course, if bone grafts are stable, then they provide for fusion, so it's better to be left in place. So there is another debate regarding the issue of instrumentation, especially pyogenic infections, because staphylococci are bacteria that form biofilm, and this is very difficult or impossible to be eradicated, so it's better to remove the implants. There are novel implants, such as titanium implants, that have less porosity or no porosity at all, so it's better for regarding biofilm formation and the preferred material for the spine. Regarding postoperative infection, there are either can be divided in early postoperative infection, that is infections that occur within 3 months from the surgical operation, and late infections after the 3 months. In early postoperative infection, optimal surgical treatment include extensive washing and lavage and debridement. The instrumentation usually is left in place, because if someone removes the instrumentation, then the patient has an infected and unstable spine. So it's better to leave the instrumentation in place. Again, if bone grafts are loose, they act as involucrum, so it's better to be removed. If bone grafts are stable, so they provide for bone fusion, so it's better to leave in place and leave in place to allow for bone union until the eradication of the infection. In late postoperative infection, implant removal is recommended, because implants are usually colonized by biofilm-forming bacteria, and also because it's not easy to debride the spine with the implants in place. The same regarding the bone grafts. If fusion has not been achieved and the bone grafts are unstable, it's better to remove. If grafts are stable, it's better to leave in place. In conclusion, the diagnosis and management of spinal infection is challenging. Most patients will do hopefully well with conservative treatment with appropriate antibiotics, bed rest, immobilization, braces, physical therapy, and rehabilitation. In the case of implants, titanium implants is the preferred material, because it has a lack of porosity and is better for microbes that do form biofilm. Close monitoring of the patient is recommended with the clinical examination and imaging. Prevention and early diagnosis are the keys for the diagnosis and management of successful management of spinal infections. The surgeon should be aware of the risk factors, comorbidities of the patient. Always consult an infectious diseases specialist, And always attend as many Wired meetings as you can, because you are going to be informed of the latest updates and novelties on spineless infections worldwide. Thank you.